And the comedy continues transatlantic style on BBC Two shortly with more of the Tracy Ullman Show.
Sophia Loren and James Coburn star in the film Firepower after the news.
This is BBC One, it's 9 o'clock. Here's Martin Lewis.
The inquest on the Clapham rail crash says it was unlawful killing. There will be no criminal charges. The Transport Secretary gives British Rail a blank cheque for safety improvements and tells them to get on with it. And an ex-army press officer sacked after exposing a dirty tricks campaign in Northern Ireland wins compensation from the government. Good evening. The 35 victims of the Clapham rail crash died as a result of unlawful killing, according to the inquest jury. The Crown Prosecution Service said the verdicts were insufficient to make it review an earlier decision not to press criminal charges against British Rail or its employees. That would only happen if new evidence was produced. Later, the Transport Secretary, Cecil Parkinson, promised that British Rail would not be inhibited in any way on safety. Whatever money BR need for safety will be available to them, he said. There will be no cash limit.
The Clapham rail disaster 21 months ago was caused by the faulty rewiring of a signal. A public inquiry last year condemned British Rail management and positively dangerous working practices. But the Director of Public Prosecutions decided not to bring any criminal charges. The coroner, Dr. Paul Knapman, said BR engineers and managers seem to be playing past the parcel with responsibility for implementing safety procedures which would have prevented the crash. But these people could not in law be considered to embody the will of the company, and so he ruled out a verdict of corporate manslaughter against British Rail. He said the jury could choose between an open verdict, accidental death, or unlawful killing.
Unlawful killing, he said, amounted to manslaughter. And if they decided on that verdict, they must be sure that an individual acted in such a way that any ordinary person would have realised there was an obvious and serious risk of physical injury to some other person on the railway.
The verdicts of unlawful killing were unanimous. Victims' relatives want those responsible prosecuted.
I'm overwhelmed. I'm pleased that responsibility has been laid for the people who have to take it. I feel a lot of compassion for some of those who will have to take the blame on their shoulders.
Well, that's absolutely brilliant. Justice has been done, and what more can we say?
I think it means that a lot of people are pretty unimpressed by British Rail's behaviour around that time. Certainly the jury seem to have taken that view. I think it means that it's going to be in the public eye for longer, which in some ways may be a shame. People have got lives to rebuild. The DPP's now got to think again. That's the next thing.
The Crown Prosecution Service said the verdicts alone would not automatically lead to the case being reopened. The Director of Public Prosecutions would require new evidence in order to review his decision not to press charges. Some civil claims for damages against British Rail still have to be settled, and the company could face heavy fines if the Chief Inspector of Railways decides to prosecute for breaches of the health and safety rules.
The coroner urged British Rail to implement the recommendations of last year's inquiry into the crash, which criticised BR's management and working practices. British Rail says most of the recommendations have been put into effect, and that its priority is to ensure that such an accident will not happen again.
The Clapham disaster happened because a technician failed to cut back a small piece of wire during weekend resignalling work at Clapham Junction. The wire slipped back into position, causing this signal to flicker from green to red and back again. A puzzled train driver stopped, and while he was calling the signal box, an express packed with commuters came round the bend, causing a disastrous crash. The public inquiry found that although the initial responsibility lay with the technician, Brian Hemingway, his faulty work should have been picked up by supervisors. But there was also sharp criticism of excessive overtime, which was said to dull the efficiency of workers. According to critics of BR, that's still happening.
We want to see our members' hours reduced, we want to see the stress of the job reduced, and we want to see more training and the opportunities for training.
£2 billion has been taken out of British Rail since 1983. And frankly, it's the cutbacks, working men longer, that has contributed to this accident. That was the financial framework they worked in. Government are responsible for that.
This government has never, ever refused an application for investment in safety. We made it clear we accept all the recommendations of the Hidden Report, and that as and when the technology is available, then the money will be put into it.
I cannot in all honesty say, as any other manager in any other industry, I believe, that accidents won't happen again. I think we can be fairly clear, though, that in this type of accident, that it is most unlikely that it would happen again, given the steps we have taken since.
Despite today's inquest verdict, it's unlikely that anyone will ever stand in the dock over the Clapham disaster. In the words of the public inquiry, there may have been incompetence, ineptitude, inefficiency and a failure of management, but in law that doesn't add up to criminal behaviour.
The American commander in Saudi Arabia, General Norman Schwarzkopf, says unexpected shipping hold-ups have delayed the build-up of United States ground forces there. And diplomatic sources in Washington have told the BBC they don't expect any military action against Iraq before Christmas.
The first American ships are now returning home from emergency service in the Middle East, including the aircraft carrier Eisenhower, as part of what will be a complex and lengthy rotation of forces. Whatever the happiness of those who are back, US military sources say it could be another 2 months before the Gulf buildup is complete. There have been technical problems with the massive air and sea lift halfway across the world. The Defense Department said 2 ships have broken down, and estimates of how much space is needed have often been wrong.
One particular operation called for 7 shiploads, and in fact, they needed 10 ships to deal with that particular load.
And the sea lift is only half complete.
The sea lift so far has delivered 326,000 tons. And they have another 318,000 tons en route today.
As well as transport problems, President Bush's determination to exhaust diplomacy first means, according to Western diplomatic sources, that an American military strike against Iraq is very unlikely before Christmas.
According to one well-informed Western diplomatic source, the United States is now likely to bide its time while the peace option of United Nations sanctions continues to take effect. That will allow the war option to be made fully ready, if necessary, for the new year.
At the State Department, diplomats are playing down prospects of Iran joining Iraq in a holy war, Tehran aiding the old enemy in Baghdad.
We have no evidence at this time that commodities have been exchanged in any significant way between Iran and Iraq. And as we have said before, we expect Iran to continue to fulfill its public commitment to abide by UN-mandated sanctions.
Meanwhile, at a tense meeting, Iraq's ambassador was called in to receive President Bush's taped television message to the Iraqi people.
I have the tape here. It is about 8.5 minutes long.
The ambassador wouldn't touch the tape, saying it should be sent by American diplomatic courier to Baghdad. Yet he promised Iraqi television would show it. But for now, it sits on a State Department desk, the presidential message unheard. Gavin Essler, BBC News, Washington.
The United States top general, Colin Powell, has called on more European allies to send ground forces to Saudi Arabia. The general, speaking during a visit to American bases in Saudi Arabia, warned that Iraqi troops could still attack the kingdom. Syria has agreed to send an armored division, including tanks and up to 15,000 men, to join the American forces in the Gulf.
In a lightning tour of the desert, military bases in desolate places, the senior soldier in America, chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, dropped in on his troops. He brought them word of how many they were. Well over 100,000, he said, though he wouldn't say how many more were coming. And he brought them word of why they were there, in the sort of straight talking he reserves for soldier-to-soldier meetings.
And what you're doing is very important because it sends a message that this is a new era, it is a new world. The United States and the Soviet Union are cooperating. The UN is working again. But there are still bad people in the world. Mr. Hussein, Saddam Hussein, is a bad person. And he's got to understand that that kind of aggression can't be tolerated.
wherever he went, and here he was with the Marine Corps' 1st Division. He was asked when they'd be going home, and he said he could not give an answer. But he scoffed at the notion that the desert conditions, the heat and the dust, were more than his men could take.
Well, you don't know the kind of soldiers we got. You don't know the kind of hoo-ah guys we got who can take it and keep going. So don't worry about my boys out there. They'll take it.
But it's not altogether, so far, an American success story. General Powell conceded there had been glitches and the build-up was now behind schedule. Also, he was able, during his tour, to spot some of the gaps in the defensive build-up and was quite specific at the end of the day on what he wanted his European allies to do.
Well, I would like to see ground presence from my European friends, and if they're going to send forces here, I would like to see armored and mechanized forces that can operate successfully on the desert.
General Powell turned aside all questions about the possible offensive use of the military force that's gathering in the desert, and on the point of whether the Iraqis should be allowed to hold on to what they have seized, he said that was not just for America, but for the whole world to decide. Martin Bell, BBC News, on the Gulf Coast of Saudi Arabia.
The United Nations Security Council is meeting tonight to decide whether food shipments should be allowed through the trade blockade of Iraq. India wants to send supplies to help feed its citizens trapped in occupied Kuwait. The Red Cross has already decided to send in medical supplies.
The Security Council gathered to consider a resolution which it already knows is impractical. It'll establish a mechanism for food and medicines to be distributed in Iraq, but only under UN control and after UN investigation. They've been told by the Secretary General that he doesn't have the ability to do that, but the permanent members want to create a system.
It's a resolution which attempts to set a framework for the treatment of food in terms of the humanitarian interest in food, a decision by the Sanctions Committee about sending food at any appropriate time, and it attempts also to deal with the question of medicine to make sure that medicine is actually going when it does go.
If there's no supervision, then they argue sanctions can be blown wide open. But Iraq's supporters say it will only lead to hardship and starvation.
There are a lot of red tape that will be created. Therefore, it will be very difficult for people to have the food they need.
The Security Council is likely to agree the plan later today and then authorized India to send one shipload of food to distribute to its nationals. But the Kuwaiti ambassador says there's no shortage of food in Iraq. It's the Iraqi authorities who are withholding it.
I mean, even in Kuwait, there are plenty of food, but the Kuwaitis are deprived from. Therefore, the attention should not focus to allow more, food to go and to be at the hand of the Iraqi government, but it should be seen that the needy people should receive this food.
The resolution which is likely to emerge here isn't going to solve the problem, but then nor is one shipload of food. What it will do is allow the Western powers to argue that if people are starving, it isn't the fault of the United Nations, it's the fault of Iraq. Brian Hanrahan, BBC News, at the United Nations.
The United Nations has accused Iraq of using food as a weapon. The woman who chairs the UN Sanctions Committee, Marietta Rassi of Finland, said there is still plenty of food in Iraq, but it's been denied to foreigners. More than 500,000 people are waiting to get out, most of them Asians, and they feel that they have been ignored.
For nearly 500,000 Asian migrant workers, like these Filipinos, there are two daily preoccupations. They are to get enough food to survive and somehow to fix evacuation from transit camps like this in Iraq, Kuwait, and on the Jordan border. The problem is there are simply too many of them for their own government's meager resources. In contrast, Western evacuees depart in highly organized style, though no Western men are allowed out. Occasionally, even pets are evacuated, not knowingly by the British authorities, but such incidents cause resentment.
A very nice Western lady, God bless her, was carrying her poodle with her. And when I heard this, believe you me, I could not sit in the room. I walked out into my bathroom and I closed the door and I cried. Now, God bless the lady and God bless her poodle. But would somebody say, God bless these poor 500,000 Indians and Pakistanis and Bangladeshis and Filipinos who need to go to their homes?
There is a very real will, certainly, on the part of the West to help, but at the same time, one mustn't allow the Iraqis to get purely off the hook. You know, they have the first responsibility for feeding people in their territory.
In Baghdad, the true level of food supplies is, in effect, a state secret. The Iraqis shrewdly keep the world guessing about how long they could hold out. And the authorities here aren't willing to permit foreigners to distribute food aid should it arrive. Even the UN can't promise that food shipped for stranded Asians won't be diverted to the Iraqi army.
Our office is a small office here. We would not have the capacity we could participate in an operation, but we would not have a capacity to monitor a large-scale food distribution to foreign nationals in Iraq.
So suspicions persist in the West that Saddam Hussein is using the food issue to undermine sanctions. An added obstacle is Iraq's refusal to let foreign relief agencies into Kuwait. That's because of Baghdad's prickly insistence on absolute sovereignty and its determination to suppress accounts of Kuwaiti resistance. Brian Barron, BBC News, Baghdad.
Here, the government has agreed to pay £30,000 compensation to Colin Wallace, a former Northern Ireland Army press officer. He lost his job in 1975 when he accused MI5 of running a dirty tricks campaign against politicians. Today's inquiry, headed by David Culker, QC, concluded Mr. Wallace was wrongly dismissed. This report from our chief political correspondent, John Harrison.
Colin Wallace tonight wasted no time. He insisted that the results of the inquiry into how he came to be sacked as an army information officer proved that MI5 was out to discredit him because he'd objected to a dirty tricks operation based in Northern Ireland.
Whitehall's main appeal machine, the Civil Service Appeal Board, has now been seen to have been nobbled by the security service, and I think that will be devastating for many civil servants.
Mr. Wallace was sacked 15 years ago for leaking a document to a journalist. A tribunal at the time refused to accept that he'd been authorised to leak the document as part of his job. Since then, he's made a series of allegations in a story that dates back to 1973, when the army in Northern Ireland launched Clockwork Orange, a black propaganda operation aimed at the IRA. Wallace claims leading politicians, including Prime Minister Harold Wilson, were also targets. He says he was asked to leak information linking senior loyalists to a homosexuality ring at the Kinkora boys' home. Having refused to cooperate with Clockwork Orange, Wallace says he was warned that he would be moved from Northern Ireland because his life was in danger. Soon afterwards, Wallace leaked information to the journalist. He was suspended and allowed to resign from the army. 5 years later, he was sentenced to 10 years imprisonment, convicted of the manslaughter of his lover's husband. Wallace was released on parole 4 years ago. He emerged protesting that he'd been framed, and since then MPs have campaigned on his behalf. Much to her embarrassment, the Prime Minister was forced to say that she'd been misled in denying that evidence of dirty tricks existed once documents linked to Clockwork Orange were discovered at the Ministry of Defence. David Culcott QC was asked to investigate. In recommending that Mr. Wallace be paid £30,000 compensation, he reveals that the Ministry of Defence contacted his disciplinary hearing beforehand. Such communication should not have happened, says Mr. Culcott. I am of the opinion that an injustice was done to Mr. Wallace. In response, the Armed Forces Minister, Archie Hamilton, in a letter to Mr. Wallace's MP, admits the government has accepted that the hearing was unsatisfactory.
There will be those who wish to argue, because of the support he's had from Calcutta, that some other parts of his concerns should be explored further. I think that we shall have to see. But for the moment, the immediate question of whether or not he was unfairly dismissed has come up with a resounding yes in his favour.
The Defence Secretary, Tom King, asked Mr. Calcutta not to write a full report. And tonight, Labour backed Mr. Wallace's call for a full judicial inquiry.
The whole relationship between the MOD and the tribunal should be investigated, and particularly why there was some interference and why the nature of the punishment seems to be excessive in relation to the misdemeanor.
Clearly, the Wallace affair has not ended with the offer of compensation.
Unemployment has gone up for the fifth month running. The government said high pay settlements had priced people out of work and called for moderate wage claims. The seasonally adjusted figure for those out of work and claiming benefit in August was 1,654,000, up by more than 22,000. Official figures show average earnings are still rising at an annual rate of 10%.
The biggest rise in unemployment for over 4 years tells the same story as this week's earlier figures for retail sales. The economic slowdown is in full swing and threatens to turn into a recession by Christmas. Government ministers were quick to put the blame for the rise in unemployment on high pay settlements, still running at 10% in July.
The level of unemployment that is derived from the slowdown in economic activity depends crucially on the level of wage settlements, and that is, I think, where we can do something to deal with this problem.
The price for the government's economic mistakes, the soaring inflation, the very high mortgage rates, the devastating trade gap, is going to be paid by ever larger rises in unemployment.
The building industry has been hit especially hard, and the Building Employers Federation has warned that 100,000 construction jobs could go by the end of 1991. There is worse news to come for the government on the pay front. Today's 10% figure for the growth in average earnings up to July doesn't include a number of big settlements already in the pipeline. The chemical giant ICI agreed 9.8% in June. British Telecom has put an offer of 10% to its workforce. In the motor industry, Vauxhall is set to pay 12.4% as part of a two-year deal. And on the same principle, Ford is likely to settle for 12.5% next month.
So that's a strong upward pressure on all other bargainers chasing inflation at the moment. But at the same time, there will be downward pressure from lack of profitability and the degree of rise in unemployment, and I think we've yet to see that have any impact.
For the moment, the Chancellor faces the worst of both worlds, high and rising unemployment and high and rising inflation, with tomorrow's figure for August likely to top 10%. His stated priority is to beat inflation, but with interest rates as his only weapon, a long plunge into recession this winter and next year is likely to be the price the economy has to pay.
The executive of the NUM has voted to accept a deal to resolve the dispute over donations from Soviet miners during the pit strike. The union will now receive over £700,000 from the Paris-based IMO, the International Miners Organization. Some executive members were critical of Arthur Scargill's role in the affair. He's president of both the NUM and the IMO.
Arthur Scargill's confidence at today's meeting wasn't misplaced. He's got what he wanted. Unanimous acceptance by the NUM's executive of the compromise deal worked out with the IMO. He sees it as a vindication.
I'm very pleased with the outcome, and I think that the statement that the General Secretary and myself made today has gone some way to demonstrate that we were all through this affair expressing what we knew to be the fact.
Money given by Soviet miners during the British coal strike is at the heart of the affair. The deal will see the return from the IMO of £700,000 of it, plus interest. Together with money already repaid by the IMO, it comes to a total of £1.7 million. In return, all legal action against Mr. Scargill and the IMO will be dropped. The deal will be put to a special conference of the union in 4 weeks' time. That's likely to back it. But it's also likely to see criticism of Mr. Scargill, criticism already voiced today.
I think that Mr. Scargill ought to be accountable to the membership of this union. I would like to see him stand for re-election.
Mr. Scargill won't do it. He's staying. But with court action brought by the government against him and the union still looming, even Mr. Scargill doesn't think that today's decision marks the end of the affair.
At least 26 people have been killed in South Africa by a gang of black youths who boarded a commuter train and attacked passengers with guns and knives. More than 100 people were injured in the attack, which took place on the outskirts of Johannesburg.
The attackers and their victims were all black. The gang, armed with guns and heavy cane-cutting knives, or pangas, ran through the train, shooting and slashing at everyone in their path. Some of the victims apparently thrown from the moving train, others trying to jump to safety. The attackers could not possibly have known the political affiliations of their victims, could not have known if they supported Nelson Mandela and the ANC, or the rival Inkatha organization of Chief Buthelezi. The only possible motive for the massacre seems to have been to terrorize the entire black community, to sow division and risk a collapse into total township anarchy. Tonight, the ANC is again accusing the government of standing back, allowing the violence to go on. And Nelson Mandela says the forces ranged against the ANC are more than just Chief Buthelezi's Inkatha.
No, it's no longer a question of Inkatha. Inkatha has become irrelevant in this matter, except that What is the killing of the people is being done under the name of God.
A Johannesburg General Hospital disaster teams have been treating scores of seriously wounded arriving in waves. This is not the first random massacre, but it is by far the worst of recent weeks, striking fear into every South African. Fear for their personal safety, but also fear for the future of their country. James Robbins, BBC News, Johannesburg.
The Social Services Committee of Rochdale Council will meet tomorrow to discuss the cases of 20 children made wards of court after allegations of satanic abuse. Public discussion of the affair was banned by an injunction until last weekend. The NSPCC has been investigating a number of the reports of ritual abuse.
20 children from one Rochdale estate were taken from their parents, put into care and made wards of court after some of the children told stories of ritualistic abuse and infanticide. 15 of the children are still in care, many without having seen their parents for months. NSPCC experts have been involved in the case. Today, though refusing to comment on the case itself, they spoke about their belief that children do not lie about abuse.
But in our experience, they usually tell the truth. And of course, quite often these children are reporting things that have happened to them, which it would be virtually impossible for children of that age to know, unless they'd been exposed in some way to the kind of behaviour they're describing.
The NSPCC have made controversial statements in the past, alleging that their workers have encountered the satanic abuse of children. Today, they said they're currently dealing with other cases. It was revealed yesterday that 13 Manchester children have also been taken into care as suspected ritual abuse victims. But there are growing complaints that parents have had no access to their children, and there might not be a High Court wardship hearing until next January. For the first time, two of the parents spoke on television today about their feelings.
I feel a bit bitter. I can't eat. I can't sleep. I've got bad news. I'm shaking as a leaf as it is now.
I just couldn't figure it out, why we should be kept in the dark. I think we've been treated very, very badly by social services.
With the facts still unknown, there's unease about whether the evidence will justify such a prolonged removal of the children, which may cause them yet more damage. But Rochdale Council, given implicit support by the NSPCC today, believes that children in these cases usually tell the truth. And the truth, when it emerges, may be a horrible one.
The main news again. The jury at the Clapham Rail Crash Inquest has returned a verdict of unlawful killing on 35 people who died. And Colin Wallace, who was sacked from the Army Press Office in Northern Ireland after making allegations of a dirty tricks campaign, has won compensation from the government. Newsnight on BBC Two at 10:30. That's the 9 o'clock news. Good night.
Newsroom Southeast, the main stories this evening. British Rail is planning major modifications to its controversial Channel Tunnel rail link through Kent. It's now been forced to reopen public consultations for the scheme before the plans go to Parliament. The changes affect the 35-mile section between Upper Halling and Cheriton and includes raising the height of the planned viaduct at Boxley. A controversial decision to close the accident and emergency department at Orsett Hospital near Grays in Essex has been announced by the government. 12,000 people have already signed a petition against the closure because they say the nearest accident unit at Basildon, 10 miles away, is too far. Meanwhile, hospitals in London are said to be facing chaos if they opt out of health authority control in next year's NHS reorganisations. The claims made in a report today by the pressure group London Health Emergency and the health service union COSY, which says funds will dry up and waiting lists will reach 250,000 by 1991. Workers at Waltham Forest in East London have been staging a 24-hour strike in protest at staff shortages. The local government union NALGO says half the posts are vacant in some departments. Robert Maxwell has denied that he wants a controlling interest in Tottenham Hotspur Football Club. Mr. Maxwell's already agreed to buy 25% of the shares, but now says he'll pull out unless boardroom squabbles are resolved quickly. Cricket stars past and present paid tribute today to Sir Len Hutton at his funeral in Kingston-upon-Thames. The former Yorkshire and England batsman died last week at the age of 74 at his home in Surrey. He still holds the record for the highest test score against Australia at 364 at the Oval in 1938. And that's all from the newsroom. We'll be back tomorrow, but for now, good night.
A very good evening to you. Well, it's fairly quiet weather in this country, but not so further afield. You can see the great black thunderclouds over northern parts of Africa pushing their way northwards, a nasty thunderstorm at the moment over southern parts of France. They're going to edge their way northwards over the weekend too. I don't think they're going to come as far north as the Channel Islands or indeed southern parts of England. In fact, in this country, we've got high pressure dominating the scene, and this front, which is giving cloud, little bits of drizzly rain at the moment, is really going to die a death as it edges its way southwards. So you can see just that drizzly rain off that front in the far northern part of Scotland. In fact, it's giving some quite windy weather too, some gales up in Shetland, I think, through tonight. And there's some patches of cloud further south, but mist and fog patches forming through the night. Could be almost anywhere, but where the cloud breaks, particularly in northern parts of England, perhaps in central and southern parts of the country as well. Not a particularly cold night, as you can see, but as that front edges its way southwards, perhaps down to about 5 degrees Celsius in the glens of Scotland or 41 degrees Fahrenheit. And then tomorrow, well, over Scotland, Northern Ireland, a pretty misty start, some mist and fog patches, a good deal of cloud around too, but I think it'll brighten up as we go through the morning. It's going to turn a good deal colder, though, on this northeastern side of Scotland in particular. Pretty windy weather there and feeling a lot colder than it has done today. Down over England and Wales, well, a fairly murky start in many places, mist and fog. There will be some patches of low cloud down in southern parts of the country, but most of that's going to have gone, I think, by the middle part of the morning. And then, although there's going to be some lumps of cloud floating around as there was today, I think most of us brightening up and seeing some sunshine, but a little bit windier, particularly down near the Channel coasts. Now, the temperature is very much the same as today, but as I've already mentioned, turning a lot colder, certainly feeling colder in that northeastern part of Scotland. And then on Saturday, dry for the most part with some sunshine, but then as we go through into Sunday, every chance of a bit of cloud and some rain coming into the far northwestern part. Well, that's it from me. Bye-bye for now.
In the first of a two-part investigation, BBC Two is now visiting the Bristol Cancer Help Centre, which was opened 10 years ago, and is committed to using alternative therapies rather than orthodox methods.
Will you fetch me one of my pills, please? Nice to see you, to see you.
Bruce Forsyth's Generation Game, tomorrow at 8:05 on One.
And now on BBC One, Sophia Loren, James Coburn and Eli Wallach join forces for a jet-setting revenge thriller in which the crashes and explosions lead to a millionaire getting his fingers burnt by firepower.